I'm going to begin this sermon series with a four-letter word. Is it a swear word? Some of you would say, yes, it is. Are you ready? Work. W-O-R-K, work. Some of you are saying, that's exactly right. It's a cuss word. It's an expletive. You may be saying, Keith, I don't want to go to work tomorrow morning. I dread Monday morning at 8 a.m. I look at my watch throughout the day. I count the hours, the minutes, and the seconds. I just can't wait to be home and be freed from it all. See, whether you're someone who is retired or a student, you understand that work is drudgery at times. There are aspects of delight, sure, but it can be difficult. Some of you would even say, it's a necessary evil. That's all it is. I just need to provide for my family and for myself, and I just need to make it through the work week. In fact, you even go so far as to exclaim, TGIF. Every week, TGIF.
Thank God it's Friday.
There we go. Thank God it's Friday. But what we have to ask is, as believers in Jesus Christ, is that what we're about? As disciples who are building other disciples and bringing Jesus to our world, is it just TGIF? I'm just going to get through. I'm going to get by. See, the truth is, I was sort of hoping that you were saying TGIF because you couldn't wait to come to in-person worship at Crossroads Bible Church. But the truth is, I know you better than that. All of us live for the weekend, don't we? Our favorite part of the week is the end. The week end. Our favorite part of work is when we stop. When Friday rolls around. But that's not true of all of you. That's what's so uncanny. Some of you actually love your job. You find value, significance, and purpose in what you do. I've pastored several churches, and Crossroads is unique in this regard. There are more people that I have interacted with at Crossroads who absolutely love what they do. Many of you see it as a calling. You see it as a ministry. Whether you're a teacher, a doctor, a lawyer, or working as a software engineer, you love what you do. But here's the issue. There's really two types of people. Two extremes. Either you view work as a curse, like a swear word, like an expletive, or you're the person who loves your job and it becomes a god to you, where you're willing to sacrifice your time, your energy, your marriage, your children, your grandchildren, and listen carefully, your church, for the sake of your God. Work, because that's your identity. Whether you view your job as a curse or a god, both are problematic. So which one are you most prone toward? Work as a curse or work as a god? Just stop and think about that for a moment. Which is it for you? See, in either case, we have extremes. And the book of Genesis is going to tell us that God has another purpose in work. And that is, he's called us, he's created us, he's designed us to work as a way of life, whether we're paid or it's voluntary, whether we're in person or whether we're staying at home to work. God wants us to see work ultimately as worship. And Genesis 1 and 2 are going to give us three foundational truths that are going to help us to see work as worship. What we're going to find is, instead of saying, "Thank God it's Friday," God doesn't want that for disciples. He wants us to be able to say, "Thank God it's Monday," because I may get to go in to the office, to the school, to the nonprofit, or I may be working from home and I get to worship the Lord, because there's value, dignity, and worth even in work. So let's look at the first foundational truth in Genesis chapter 1. The first foundational truth is God is a worker. In other words, God demonstrates his greatness, his grandeur, his glory through what he does. We're going to start with the very first verse in the Bible, Genesis 1, verse 1. Now, before I read this verse, I want to be very clear about something. This sermon is an overview. I'm not going to answer a lot of the questions that you have on Genesis 1 and 2. That's not the purpose of this sermon. This sermon is the umbrella, if you will, for our six-week sermon series, Work is Worship. So if you want some questions answered on Genesis, you're going to have to study for yourself. And that's how we learn the best, isn't it? It's not through a sermon per se. It's by you digging in for yourself. But let's read the first verse of the Bible. Genesis 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So God himself is creator. We will discover not only is he creator, he's the sustainer of the universe. That's what that phrase, heaven and earth, refers to. Now in Genesis 1 and 2, seven times God creates. 12 times God makes. The language of Genesis, penned by Moses, makes it clear that God is a worker. Now, in case we doubt that, if you turn over to Genesis chapter 2, verse 2, God's activity during the days of creation is called work in Genesis chapter 2, verse 2. Now, drop down from Genesis 2, verse 2 to verses 7 and 8. And I want you to look at these verses with me. Genesis chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. Then the Lord God formed man of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. The Lord God planted a garden toward the east in Eden, and there he placed the man whom he had formed. Now, what type of language is this? Earthy, physical. Look at the verbs. In verse 7, formed, breathed. In verse 8, planted, placed, and formed. Do you see the language? God is creating. He is speaking. He is forming. He is shaping. He is building. God is a worker. In fact, God is always working. See, we can go all the way back to creation and say, yes, God did work. That's clear from Genesis 1 and 2. But God continues to sustain his creation. He preserves human life. God loves the world. He judges people, even in this life. He shepherds. God is always working. He's building up his church. He's doing the greatest work of all. He is bringing people to faith in Jesus Christ. Is God a worker? Yes, he is. But the question is often asked, yeah, I understand that God is a worker. But what about Jesus, God's son, the second member of the Trinity? In order to determine that, we have to go to the Gospels, and we need to ask, was Jesus a worker? Well, we know this. Jesus was a carpenter or an artisan. He worked with wood, stone, iron. Church tradition tells us that Joseph and Jesus, they made yokes and plows. They worked with their hands. Jesus did that for 90% of his life and ministry. 90%! Demonstrating that no matter what our task, no matter what our labor, whether it's seemingly menial or professional, it's all valuable to Jesus. What did Jesus do when he started his public ministry? He recruited 12 men from the workplace, not from the synagogue. He recruited workers, fishermen, tax collector, men just like you and me. Look at Jesus' earthly ministry. 132 appearances throughout the Gospels. 122 took place in the workplace. Look at Jesus' parables. 52 different parables. 45 have a workplace backdrop. Was Jesus a worker? Absolutely. Was God a worker? Yes. So if both God and Jesus were workers and are workers, how should we respond? By celebrating their work. Psalm 46, verse 10 says, "Be still and know that I am God." In other words, we should be looking at the Godhead's works and celebrating God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Yesterday, Lori and I saw Mount Rainier in all of its glory, in all of its splendor. And just looking at it, we couldn't help but say, there's a God in heaven. That's just one mountain. There's so many other evidences in creation of, remember, God's autograph. When God wants to demonstrate who he is and all that he is, what does he do? He shows his power. Why does God work? Romans chapter 1, verse 20 tells us, to demonstrate his invisible attributes and to make them evident. His eternal power, his divine nature. God works to show himself off. God also works because he finds satisfaction in what he does. Genesis chapter 1, verse 31. After God created, he says, "It is very good." He looked back at his creation and he said, "Wow!" He was impressed with how he created and what he made. We need to give him praise for creation, for that sunset, for the sunrise, for the mountains, for the oceans, for the lakes, for the stars, for the planets, for the human body in all of its intricacies. God is creator. But we don't stop there. We celebrate him as the sovereign, as the judge, as the shepherd, as the lover, as the wooer who brings people to faith in Christ, which is the greatest miracle of all. We celebrate God and Jesus as workers. So the first foundational truth is God is a worker. The second foundational truth is God created you as a worker. We're going to discover in Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 through 28, the verses that Callie read, that God has created you and called you to work. Look at these verses with me. "Then God said, 'Let us make man in our image.'" The us and the our is referring to the plurality of the Godhead. The Trinity, three persons in one, is not fully revealed, obviously, until the New Testament. But this is pointing to the fact that God exists in plurality and in community, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created him. God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the sky and over every living thing that moves on the earth." Twice, God says that he created humankind in his own image. Now, there are dissertations written on this topic. And remember, this sermon is an overview. So we're hardly going to touch on this issue. But what we can see clearly is we were created in God's image. Verse 26, repeated in verse 27. For the purposes of this text, what we know is God created work for us before he created us. He had this purpose designed for Adam and Eve before they were brought into the world. In fact, God created a task for Adam before he even gave him a wife in Eve. Now, my observation from that is, men, if you're interested in marrying a young woman, you better have a job first. Now, that's just key speaking. I'm not going to say that from Scripture, because this is a narrative text, but I will say this: a woman's greatest need is security. And if you don't have a job, you're probably not ready to marry a woman. Work is even prior to the family unit. Work is prior in the mind of God to even Adam being brought into the world. Verses 26, 27, and 28 make that clear. For our purposes, what we're focused in on is that God has called humankind to rule. That is humankind's primary work. There are four other commands, but we're not going to touch upon those commands today. Rulership over creation is what God called humankind to. And when you fast forward to Revelation 21 and 22, we see it again, that we will rule with Jesus Christ one day, just like we were intended to rule in the beginning in the Garden of Eden. So you have the Garden of Eden, you have the new heavens and the new earth, you have the bookends of the Bible, and they have to do with you and me working, and with us ruling and reigning with our Creator. It's incredible to even contemplate. So why did God give humankind work? Why did he give Adam work in the beginning? Was it that he couldn't manage the garden on his own? Did he want to give Adam some busy work? You know, occupy him in this paradise? Some of you are like, yeah, I think either one of those options are viable. Of course not. Both of those options are erroneous. He gave humankind work for the same reason that he himself worked, to satisfy himself. God loves it when his people work. And here's what's important for us to understand. Work is an expression of our worship. We often don't think deeply enough about the fact that we were created in the image of God. We have value, dignity, and worth. We reflect God. We represent God. And how do we do that with most of our time? Work. Well over a third of our lives will be spent working. And if work doesn't have a role in worship, and worship doesn't have a role in work, Christianity is quite irrelevant for this life. Have you ever stopped and reflected on that? If work is all grind for you and no glory, That was never God's intent for you. That wasn't his intent for anyone. God wants us to see work as a means of worshiping him. And it could be, as some scholars argue, that work is the principal way that you and I worship the living God. But when we think about worship, we often think of 2 hours reserved for Sunday morning. If that's all that worship is, that's sad. Worship is Monday through Saturday as well as Sunday morning. In fact, Sunday morning is designed for us to say, Lord, I'm giving you my best. I'm giving you my first. I'm worshiping you, and then you're empowering me and enabling me to live my life for you Monday through Saturday in the real world where all of you live. People always ask me about my calling to ministry, and I'm glad to tell them about it because I had a very dramatic call. Note to self, never vow that you will not be a pastor. Don't ever make that vow. But when it comes to my call to ministry, I always have to say, you know, I was also a stock boy. I was a shop hand. I was a salesman. I've done a number of other jobs, and they have not been necessarily impressive. I was a janitor, and so I have great respect for those in the custodial industry. I think anyone who goes into vocational ministry needs to do some custodial work first. It's just part and parcel of learning to serve and to demonstrate servant leadership like Jesus when Jesus washed the disciples' feet in John 13. So I have to tell people, those jobs allowed me to worship the Lord. They allowed me to have a vertical focus and to give God glory. Did they have the same impact that perhaps I have as a pastor? Not necessarily. But it was a means that I could worship God. And every job that we have, regardless of the impact we think we're having, God wants to bless. Did you know that over 3/4 of the heroes in Scripture were not pastors, missionaries, or religious figures? They were tent makers. They were shepherds. They were farmers. They were tax collectors. They were fishermen. They were business persons. All kinds of tasks were utilized by God's people down throughout time to the present time. And that allowed the gospel to go out into the outermost parts of the world. If it was dependent upon those that make their living vocationally from the gospel, world evangelization would have never happened. It requires people like you who will go into the marketplace and who will name the name of Christ and share him with coworkers, with classmates, with neighbors, so on and so forth. One of the things that we need to recognize is there's a distinction that theologians have made down throughout time between an occupation and a vocation. Listen carefully. An occupation is that which allows us to make a living, to pay bills, to provide for our family. A vocation is synonymous with calling. In fact, it's the Latin term for calling. We hope that our occupation and our vocation come together and mesh in some way, shape, or form. But that's not always the case. You won't always make your living from perhaps your present or ongoing vocation or calling. Let me give you a few examples. Stay-at-home persons. Dads, moms, who will stay at home. They're not paid. There's not a lot of glory or seeming significance in that at all times. But boy, is it a call. It's a vocation that's unpaid. In fact, did you know that the average American in his or her lifetime will work about 100,000 hours? I always double that when it comes to stay-at-home parents. I mean, double the work hours. And yet, so often, they're given honorable mention at best. We need to esteem that role. The role of students. Whether you're a middle school student, a high school student, a college student, a graduate school student, it's easy to think, well, I'm not working. And I'm not going to have my occupation until I graduate from high school or I graduate from college. There may be truth in that. But even if you don't have your occupation, you have your vocation, your calling. What are you called to do as a student? To read books, to do homework, to take tests for the glory of God, with the goal of making a difference in the world as a disciple maker. That means that taking 8th grade biology next year, or if you're a college student, philosophy 103 at Bellevue College, those classes that seem absolutely irrelevant, they're a part of your calling. They're a part of your vocation, and God wants you to glorify Him through that. A third example are retired people. Often, we spend all of our time and energy, and even investing our finances, so that we can be retired. We can own a second home. We can live somewhere sunny. We can play golf as much as we want. But here's the truth. That's not your vocation. That's not your calling. Your calling is not to be retired, but to be refired. To serve in the community, to volunteer here at Crossroads. You won't find satisfaction any other way. Will you receive a paycheck? Most likely no. These roles don't provide income, but they're a part of your calling if God has called you to that. See, whatever God has called you to do, it's incredibly significant. And God wants you, whether you're a financial planner, whether you're a software engineer, whether you're a lawyer, a doctor, a nurse, a teacher, whatever your occupation, He wants you to have a sense of vocation and calling. I want to show you something from Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. I believe the Apostle Paul, in a passage that we are very familiar with, hearkened back to the creation account in Genesis 1 and 2 that we've been looking at. And this is a passage that's very familiar to many of us. The Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast." So here we have some of the clearest verses in the Bible on the fact that the gift of salvation, of eternal life, is free. It's all by grace. So if you've heard me talking about the significance of work and the purpose of work and how you need to work your tail off, yes, there's truth in this, but as a means of worship. The only way you can do that, to the degree that God wants you to, is by experiencing His grace and having His grace empower you and enable you to be able to say, thank God it's Monday. Thank God I can actually serve the Lord as a disciple. If you've never trusted in Jesus Christ, ask for His grace. Stop working, at least to achieve heaven. Stop working. Start trusting. Say, Lord Jesus Christ, you have done the work. You lived a perfect life. You fulfilled all of God's commandments. You died on the cross. You rose from the dead. I'm trusting in you, the ultimate worker, so that I might have a relationship with you through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. But then don't miss verse 10. For we are his, God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. I believe that verse 10 is Paul reflecting back on the creation account of Genesis 1 and 2. I'll just demonstrate it quickly. That term workmanship is only used one other place in the New Testament, in Romans chapter 1, verse 20. And it's used about God's work in creation from one of the greatest passages on creation in the Bible. The verb in verse 10, created, is used in Matthew chapter 19 by Jesus of the creation of the first man and the first woman. It's used in Romans 1. It's used in Colossians 1. It's used in 1 Corinthians 11 of God having created. And specifically, even having created humankind. We even see that works have been predestined for us. One other use, Romans 9, verse 23, of God choosing us from before time for his purposes. What are his purposes? Works, plural. But here's what we've done. We've said those works are primarily designed for Christian obedience in quote, spiritual or religious settings, not secular. But I think I've already established the Bible doesn't know anything about spiritual, secular divisions or laity and clergy distinctions. Work is worship. All work can be worship unless it's immoral or unethical, right? Thank God it's Monday. God has designed us, even in this familiar passage, to work for him. And the works, plural, that he is referring to have a backdrop in the creation account that we've been looking at. So perhaps we need to say, thank God it's Monday. That Monday is coming tomorrow and we get to worship God through our work. We've seen two foundational truths. God is a worker. And God created you as a worker. We're going to see a third and final foundational truth, and that is God created you as his co-worker. This gets good. The invisible God is choosing to use people like you and me, ordinary folks, to bring the invisible God into a visible reality. That when people look at us in our work, they see God's nature, God's characteristics, God's work. Look again at a verse we've already looked at, chapter 2, verse 8. The Lord God planted a garden toward the east in Eden, and there he placed the man whom he had formed. Now drop down to verse 15. Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it. We have God placing Adam in the garden to work prior to the fall. We could all probably say our work is a little cursed because chapter 3, verse 17 says, that now we have to labor and toil, and it can be painful. Chapter 3, verse 18 says, there's now thorns and thistles, there's hardships, there's frustrations, there's trials. But that doesn't depreciate the fact that work cannot be worship. It is worship. So here, Moses explains to us that God placed the original man in the Garden of Eden, notice, to cultivate it and keep it. In other words, to get his hands dirty. To be able to do what God had called him to do in partnership with God, who started the process. But here's something that we rarely reflect on, and many of us may not know. Cultivate and keep or some of your English versions will translate these two terms differently, elsewhere in the Hebrew Bible are translated worship and serve. I consider this a double entendre, where the primary meaning is referring to working the garden, practical, tangible, earthy, physical work. But what Moses and the Lord are saying is, it's actually worship. It's serving God. So we have both meanings evident in all work. Thank God it's Monday, because we're going to be able to show off God and God's work in our lives. So how can we go about worshiping God? How can we go about having the right view of work? I'm going to make three quick suggestions. First of all, recognize work as a gift from God. Our tendency is to say, I don't like my job. My job is mundane. I'm not really making a difference. I feel that way. You feel that way. But what we have to recognize is work is a gift from God. It was really the first gift that God gave humankind outside of his presence. Have you thanked him for the gift of work, that you have life, breath, and being, and that he allows you to worship him, to serve him? If you haven't, do so today. We know from Ecclesiastes, at least chapter 5, verses 18 and 19, that work is a blessing. That we're to eat, drink, be merry, but to find joy in our work. Under the sun, as Ecclesiastes was written, we can find satisfaction. Above the sun, we can find eternal reward for the gift of work. Secondly, we need to pray that God will bless our work. In Psalm chapter 90, Moses writes a song, just like I believe Moses wrote the book of Genesis. And he says twice in verse 17, confirm your work in us. Confirm your work. Bless our work. Bless the work of Israel. Bless the work of Crossroads Bible Church. The Apostle James says, we have not because we ask not. And this is in the context of trials. If your job is one big trial, ask God to bless it. Ask God to bless you in the midst of a thankless job. Ask God to allow you to impact people in the workplace or online or from home. Ask him every day. If you start your day at home and remain at home all day, pray throughout the day. If you leave home and you commute, pray on your commute. Pray on your return commute. Lord, bless my efforts. They may be meager, bless them in a powerful way. Lastly, consider work a call of God. Even if you're not feeling it, even if you haven't found your niche or your sweet spot, know that whatever God has you doing at this moment, it's his will for you in Christ Jesus. And do it for his honor and glory. See it as an opportunity for you to worship him by being a person who's filled with humility, integrity, and purity. Be a bold witness for Christ. Be someone who shows Christ's hands, his feet, his face to people who desperately need him. See it as a calling. Because here's the truth. Each and every one of you, whether you're a young student, a child, all the way through someone who's a seasoned saint and hopefully refired, you're all in full-time Christian ministry. You're all serving the Lord. Whether you make your income from that or not, we're building disciples who bring Jesus to our world. So we should be able to say, thank God it's Monday. I love the story from many years ago of a reporter who interviewed three stonemasons. They were building a great building, And the reporter asked the first one, "What are you building?" And the mason said, "I'm chipping away at stone." So the reporter moved to the second mason, and he said, "What are you doing?" And the mason said, "I'm building a wall." So finally, the reporter moved to the third mason, and he said, "What are you doing?" And this last mason, he looked up at the large building, and he said, "I'm building a cathedral." All three masons were building the very same building. They were working on a cathedral, but only one had the right perspective. Your perspective makes all the difference. Is work worship, or is it not? No matter how difficult your job is, no matter how little you're paid, no matter how underappreciated you are, no matter how difficult it is working for your boss or working with your coworkers, is work worship? Are you doing what you do for God's honor and glory? Thank God it's Monday, because we're going to go out from here and we're going to build disciples and we're going to worship the Lord. If you're physically able, I'd like you to stand at this time. I'm going to do something seemingly unusual. I'm going to commission you for work. And as a church family, we're going to worship the Lord and ask that the Lord will send us out from here and use us in a powerful way. Father, we thank you and praise you for each and every person here who is saying right now, "I'm ready to work. I'm ready to serve. But most of all, I'm going to worship you, the one true God, the living God." Lord, we pray as we begin a work week that we would do what you've called us to do for your honor and glory, whether we're paid or unpaid, whether we're young or old, whether we're staying at home or we're going into the marketplace of work. We are prepared to worship you. And we are asking, Lord, that Crossroads Bible Church will make a profound difference throughout King County and abroad. That when people think of Crossroads, they say, "I may not agree with everything that that church believes, but man, do they work." And they seem to work for someone far greater than themselves. Father, we commission ourselves. I commission every sister and brother in Christ to go out and to worship you through this principal way of through our time, our energy, and our gifting you've given us for worship. Help us to use this stewardship for your honor and glory. We thank you, Lord, for setting us apart and for sending us out. We ask now for the grace that we might fulfill the works that you've called us to. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.